truly excited that you're watching. The image on the screen up there shows my level of excitement, and I use that picture because that's a much cuter face than my actual super excited face. If you know me, you know how often I talk about looking for a reason to get excited every day. And I have to say that it's been a good week for me because I've been excited all week for today. I know that the teaser that I posted earlier in the week has some of you excited as well. I know that, before we get to it, I want to share some scripture and some music with you by way of video. I'm going to start with a word of prayer, so let's bow our heads. God, we love you. We thank you for this opportunity to once again gather together and to worship you and to hear from your word. Father, I feel like what's coming from your word today may very well be the most important truth that's contained in your word. It's the truth that once we can grasp a hold of it and accept it, is the basis of all of our other relationships, including our relationship with your son, Jesus. And I thank you for that, and it's in his name that I pray. Amen.
John 3:16.
For God so loved the world,
the whole world,
everyone,
anyone,
that's a lot of people,
that he gave his one and only son,
his only son,
that whoever believes in him
will not perish,
but have eternal
life.
Wow. Wow, indeed. Normally, I would show that video to a group of fellow Christians, and it would lead me into talking about the fact that God made that sacrifice for everyone, not just for those who were his people at the time. I would challenge us to find a way to let people who have not yet believed it come to a better understanding of that truth. Because there's a lot of misconception in the world today concerning what's necessary for a person to benefit from the sacrifice. Today, though, I'm excited because I'm not going down that road. I'm excited because I'm not here to challenge the church as a whole today. Hold that thought.
Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. Oh, they are weak. Oh, he is strong.
Child, come on in.
Bible, it says me. So
what a wonderful truth, wouldn't you agree? If you haven't figured out where I'm going with this, you will in just a few minutes. As we've been doing as part of our recorded worship service, before I let the cat out of the bag concerning what I'm so excited about, we will pause. We'll do as Jesus commanded just before facing his accusers. We'll pause to remember him. And to remember that Jesus chose simple, everyday things as a way for us to remember him. In John chapter 6, we read of Jesus feeding 5,000 plus people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. The New International Version of the Bible actually says 5 small loaves and 2 small fish. Next, we read of Jesus walking on water. Then, beginning at verse 24, it says, once the crowd noticed that Jesus and his disciples weren't there anymore, they went looking for them. It was the next day. They found Jesus. Jesus knew why they had come. He made it clear to them that he understood that they hadn't come because the things he had shown them had brought them to belief in him. They'd followed because he'd satisfied their physical hunger, and now, being the next day, they were hungry again. They questioned what Jesus had to say. Some in the crowd were asking for yet another sign so that they might believe. Then Jesus says this in verse 35 of John chapter 6, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. It's interesting that immediately following that, in the rest of John chapter 6, we read that many of the disciples then deserted Jesus. They were only in it for what was in it for them, physically and in the moment. Keep in mind that this was well before Jesus broke the bread and gave thanks and blessed it, saying, do this in remembrance of me. He talked of satisfying both hunger and thirst long before he took the cup and blessed it, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Take and drink. From his ministry among the people to his last meal with his closest disciples, Jesus' message never changed. He is the bread of life, and his blood shed on the cross is the new covenant between God and his people. It is only through that that we can realize forgiveness of sin. So we pause, we remember, we eat the bread, and we drink from the cup in remembrance of Jesus. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for using such simple things to remind us of such a magnificent event. The life of Jesus, his life, his death, his burial, his resurrection, it is all included in what we remember. So as the church members partake of this communion, Father, I pray that they would open their hearts and their minds to what it is that you would have them know about your Son and our Savior, Jesus. And it's in his name I pray. Amen.
Take this wine. Now the sample made divine for any to receive. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we to worship, and as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you.
You've probably heard that Jesus Love Me song, Jesus Loves Me song before. You may have been taught it at a very early age. You may have heard it hundreds, if not thousands of times in your life. There's a new song with the same title. It's done by a group of worship singers that you may be familiar with. They call themselves Hillsong, and the newest generation of them is known as Hillsong Young and Free. I only tell you that so you can look for the song if you choose. And I only bring it up because the first few lines of the song are something so exciting that I believe they need to be repeated. The song starts like this. It was just three words, but it changed my life. Just a childlike truth that consumed my mind. From my life's first breath, till the day I rise, all I need to know is this age-old line. Jesus loves me, this I know. I won't forget that the Bible says that he loves me so. I hear those words and I ask myself, really? It seems to me that we, and when I say we, I'm including myself, it seems to me that we often forget that Jesus loves us. If your experience is anything like mine, though, there was a time when the reality of knowing that Jesus loves you changed your life. It was all we needed to know. Nothing else mattered. It may have defined for you the reason you're here, the reason you live. After all, isn't that the $64,000 question? Don't we all at some point wonder about the meaning of life? Isn't it exciting to know that the meaning of life, the reason for existence, is that the creator of the universe, the almighty one and only God, loves you so much that he wants a relationship with you? I don't know about you, but that's pretty exciting to me. I want you to be excited by that fact too. If you give it deep thought, it would be almost impossible to not be excited by that fact. Here's the thing, though. I'm afraid that we don't give much deep thought to the fact that Jesus loves us. We don't give much deep thought to the fact that this Jesus, who the Bible tells me loves me, is in fact God, the creator of the universe in the flesh. That's a big deal, church. And here's the most exciting thing of all, as far as I'm concerned. Even if you don't believe a word that I've said so far, and even if you don't believe a word that's written in the Bible, none of that changes the fact that Jesus, that God, loves you. Isn't that cool? I think it's cool. There's nothing you can do to make him love you more And there's nothing you can do to make you love him, to make him love you less than he does right now. And there's nothing you can say or do that can change the fact that he loves you. That is an absolute truth that cannot be changed. And that's exciting. Because guess what that means? It means that takes all the pressure off. It means that all of the time and energy you've been spending on things that you think God will make God love you more, all of that time is now free time. And all of that energy can be used for something else. I'd suggest we use it to love others and to let them know that God loves them too. But that's just me. So my desire for our time together today is to get you from the point of saying, in a generic kind of way, Jesus loves me, to saying in a very enthusiastic way, Jesus loves me. Take it to heart. It's a personal relationship between you and God. It's not a feeling. It's not an emotion. It's an action on the part of God. He loves you. I pray that each day you'll say with force, this I know. I'm convinced of it. What it takes to be able to do that every day is the ability to shut out the noise of the world around you. It takes setting aside the opinions of people and remembering and focusing on what God thinks of you. And I'm going to say this over and over and over and over and over again. God loves you. Whose opinion could possibly mean more to you than the one who created you? And whose opinion could be more true than the opinion of the one who created you? Listen, I know that we as humans put stock in what other people think of us. We want people to think we're attractive. We want people to think we're intelligent. We want them to think we're successful. We even want them to think that we know what we're talking about and that we're right. We want people to think the best of us. The problem that we run into, though, folks, is twofold. First, and I know for some of you this is going to be hard to believe, but there are some people who don't have a high opinion of you. And second, we aren't always worthy of such a high opinion, are we? There's actually a third fold to that. Sometimes we don't have a very high opinion of ourselves. And I think that makes God sad. I'm just being honest here. I know I mention it a lot. If you want to see what people think of you, share something on social media. I can only talk about Facebook because that's what I use. And my experience there tells me that unless you post something really outrageous, you'll get lots of love, lots of positive comments, and you'll also get some hateful, negative responses. Here's the issue for most of us. Because we care what people think of us, we zero in on and respond to the negativity. We respond to the hate. People can give you thumbs up all day long and you don't respond at all. We do that because we care what people think of us and we want them to understand that we're right. We want them to agree with us. I've got a newsflash for you. Not everybody likes you, and it goes even deeper than that. Some of the people who say they like you don't really like you. At least not all the time. They only like you to a point. Social media has taught us that there are things we can do, either positive or negative, that will alter other people's opinion of us. That's a lot of pressure to be under, isn't it? Here's the thing that I want you to keep in mind. You already know it. As usual, nothing I'm saying today is new to you. And I'm also not immune to any of the pressures that I've already mentioned. I do my very best to not be concerned about the opinion of others. The reality is, though, that we get offended when people don't like something about us, regardless of what that is. Now I'm going to climb down off of that soapbox and get on to another one. It's time to get to the important stuff. It's time to get to the exciting part. It's time to get to the truth. And the truth is, God loves you. The truth is, as it says in Genesis 1:27, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. I don't care if you're male or female, you are created in the image of God. Yes, I'm talking to you. And if you're created in his image, you have the ability to reflect that image into the world around you. The truth is that God loves you. And the truth is, there's nothing you can do or anyone else can do that's ever going to change that. Romans 8 says, in the words of the Apostle Paul, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. God's love is forever. He made that a certainty when he allowed Jesus to die on the cross. If you are a believer, if you are a follower of Jesus, if you call yourself a Christian, you should be so excited about that that you can't keep it in. And I want even those who might be watching and who don't yet have a relationship with Jesus to know and to be excited by the truth that God loves you just as much as he does anyone else. He loves us with all our warts and scars and shortcomings and bad hair days and differing opinions on current events and past bad deeds and anything else you can think of that would cause someone to stop loving you. None of that matters. God loves you. Jesus loves you, this I know. And because I know that, I'm excited today. Remember this. When all of the negative opinions of others, and even the negative opinions that we sometimes have of ourselves, get in the way of our thinking, the only opinion that has eternal, forever significance is God's opinion. And guess what? He loves you. Nothing can change God's love for you. Let me pray. God, thank you for your love. I don't know what else to say. There are so many things that come with your love that we can be thankful for. I just pray that we would push everything else aside for a short period of time today and focus on the fact that no matter what else happens in this world, in our lives, in our homes, in our families, you love each and every one of us with an unconditional, forever, eternal love. And we thank you for that. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Before I go, you thought I forgot, but let me say Happy Mother's Day to all the moms who are watching. I have one more video that I want to leave you with. And when I first heard this song, I immediately thought that the singer was directing it at a woman or at women in general. And so I thought I'd play it on Mother's Day. After hearing it a number of times, though, I'm convinced that it applies to all of us. So all I ask is that as the song plays, please just stay focused on the mirror.
Some days I know you see your face in the mirror, and your eyes rest on every flaw. You try to hide and cover your imperfections, but you really don't feel better at all. Don't worry, don't worry. He already thinks you're beautiful. He loves you just the way you are. And nothing you can do could ever change his point of view. He already thinks you're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. There's no mistakes in how he puts you together, even when it's hard for you to see. No need to try and become somebody different. Only thing you gotta do is believe it. He already thinks you're beautiful. He loves you just the way you are. And nothing you can do could ever change his point of view. He already thinks you're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. When you can see it, beautiful. And when you can't, beautiful. Hope, beloved, don't forget. You're beautiful. At your weakest, beautiful. And at your best, beautiful. Hope, beloved, don't forget. Don't you just the way you are. Oh, and nothing you can do could ever change his point of view. He already thinks you're beautiful.
Remember that. God loves you and he thinks you're beautiful. Have a great week.